Here's something which I think is perfect for adding a cassette deck to your stereo system without taking up a lot of space. It's the RCA SCT-510 stereo cassette tape deck, sold by Radio Shack in the early 2000s. This was the successor to the SCT-86 cassette deck, sold under the Realistic and Optimus brands. Changes from that model to this one include a more squared-off cabinet instead of an angled top like the SCT-86 had. Also, it has automatic tape type selection instead of a manual push-button switches to select the tape type. And also the mechanism has been changed. Instead of buttons that kind of push in, the buttons push down on this one, which I think is better because on the SCT-86, the buttons are stiff enough that when you try to push on them, you would tend to push the whole thing around. But this, since they face downwards, that's not a problem. And this has all the basic features you need to make a decent cassette deck and the bare minimum amount of space, and with no extra frills, which is a good thing after so many years when the more complex cassette decks tend to be unreliable and difficult to repair. And unlike the new cassette decks sold today, even the expensive ones like the Tascam 202 Mark 7, this does support recording onto metal tape, and it also does have Dolby B noise reduction. It also has left and right level meters, manual level controls for your recording, and a tape counter. Other than that, it's a pretty basic mechanism with manual piano key controls, but it does have full automatic stop and a soft eject door. I believe the mechanism it uses was made by Tanishin, which is basically the one company left that's still making cassette deck mechanisms today, which are basically using the same exact design as this, pretty much. So it's not necessarily the highest quality, but it should be pretty reliable because there's not a lot to go wrong with this. It's a very simple mechanism, and the belts should be very easy to replace. But being from the early 2000s, this model should still be new enough that you shouldn't need to have to replace the belts unless you happen to find one that was very heavily used. On the back, it has the typical RCA jack, which is ironic because it is an RCA, line level inputs and outputs, as well as left and right microphone inputs, and a switch to select either line level inputs or microphone inputs, which is something you don't see on a lot more fancy cassette decks, microphone inputs. According to the date code sticker, this one was made in December 2001, so as of when I'm recording this video in December 2018, it's exactly 17 years old. And just to put the size of this thing in perspective, this is a typical high-quality full-size cassette deck. It's my Nakamichi. And here is the little RCA. So, takes up less than a quarter of the space. So if you have a rack or shelf that's designed to accommodate the standard 17-inch wide audio components in the same space as a full-size cassette deck, you could fit one of these little RCA decks as well as an 8-track player, so you can cover all your bases of the most popular tape-based music formats, or various other little components like a phono preamp or a switch box or a timer or a level meter or whatever else could fit in that space. Here's the inside. The power transformer is mounted in the back of the case, and once you unscrew it, it just comes apart like this, and it's very easy to service. It looks like the only thing you need to do to change the belts is just remove this one screw here, and then the motor should be able to come off its bracket, and then you can get access to the belts. There's two belts here and then one belt for the counter over here, but these are all the original belts and they're still fine. And there's also the speed adjustment for the motor. I did have to do one repair to the circuit board because these input and output jacks are mounted directly to the circuit board, and this thing must have been dropped or something and hit these jacks, and it cracked a trace on the board, so I had to jumper it with a small wire, which I probably didn't do a very neat job of, but it works. And there's the Dolby B noise reduction encoder and decoder chip. It's a Sony CXA1551P. And you can see the various adjustment trimmers surrounding it. And then in this part of the circuit board, you can see two more trimmers. I would guess these are for adjusting the recording bias, because you can see some of the bias oscillator coils there and down here. To try it out with, I hooked it up to a cheap pair of computer speakers. I'll give you a direct hookup later so you can really hear what this thing sounds like. I also bought some new pre-recorded music cassettes. Speaking of which, I've heard that so far in 2018, sales of cassettes have more than doubled compared to last year. So I don't know if cassettes will ever have as big of a comeback as vinyl records. But nonetheless, new albums are being released on cassette. You can find them on places like Amazon or Urban Outfitters, which is where I got these tapes. Or if you go on sites like Bandcamp, you can find cassettes from independent artists like Slugbug. That's where I got this tape. And this is actually a quadraphonic cassette. You can see it mentioned here in the liner notes. He calls it a Bug Sound Quad Matrix, but I believe it's a Sansui QS encoder that he used for this album. There's Paul Miller, aka Slugbug, and all his studio equipment. And since I know it won't give me any copyright claims, let's start out with the Slugbug tape, which appears to be on high bias tape because it's almost pitch black, whereas regular Type 1 ferric tape is kind of a brown color. Doesn't mention anything about Dolby noise reduction, so I'll leave that off for now. Although you can see, even though it's high bias tape, it only has the standard holes here. It's not the wider holes, so this will detect it as a normal bias tape, which is typical for pre-recorded cassettes. Even the ones that are on chrome tape, they're designed to be played back in the normal bias position. Sounds fine. Let's try fast-forwarding. Doesn't have automatic program search or anything, so it doesn't automatically find the next track. Now let's try rewinding. Now, the one good thing about this is that I mentioned it's full automatic stop. So when it gets all the way to the end of the tape, it should stop automatically instead of just sitting there and straining the motor like some really cheap cassette decks do. Nice quiet mechanism. You can see the counter going. There. Stopped automatically, and we can reset the counter to zero. Now I'll give you some direct hookup audio samples from this cassette deck.
above me saying, girl, you better get back home. But I feel lucky.
So I think the RCA SCT-510 is great for adding cassette deck functionality to an existing stereo system without taking up a lot of space. That's why I call it the Add-A-Cassette deck. It's not terribly common because it was only sold for a couple years. Right now, as of when I'm recording this video, there's two of them on eBay, both with an asking price of about $45, which I think is too high, even for one in perfect condition. But the most recent one that sold on eBay sold for around $24, which I think is a much more reasonable price. And you can always look for the SCT-86, which was the predecessor to this model, and which I did a video about a couple years ago. Very similar deck, and you can usually find that model more easily. And if you're a fan of more of a chrome and wood grain type of styling, Radio Shack did have a deck back in the 80s called the SCT-34, but that version is much more basic. It does not have manual level control. It's only automatic level control. It also does not have Dolby noise reduction. And aside from Radio Shack, I've only been able to find one other company that made a very similar sized cassette deck, and that was Audiologic, a brand name of the Randix company. It was their TCD-34 model, and it was also very basic with only automatic level control and no Dolby noise reduction, although it does mention what they called noise reduction control system, which I think is their name for DNR, dynamic noise reduction. And finally, there was the Audiologic TCD-25 cassette deck, a very unusual vertically oriented cassette deck designed to go with a similarly styled mini system of components. Very, very unusual and probably very rare. It has Dolby B noise reduction, manual recording level controls, and beautiful lighted analog view meters. I'd love to get this entire system, in fact, someday, but it's probably very difficult to find.
Okay, that was Rumba. Rumba.
Turn that organ off now.
He hit me.
Turn the organ off. Turn that off.
It doesn't make noise. But it doesn't make noise, though. I'm recording stuff. Somehow my mom got grouchy. Well, I'm walking over here. Tommy hit me.